we have a lot of work to do, especially in the continent, where what has characterized our long history has been a constant, permanent loss of wealth, which probably characterizes our historical trajectory more than anything.
So the first thing that we used to do is land reform. And land reform in the way that you were saying, meaning that you take the debt from those who have and give to those who don't have. And you don't have to pay for that. So you can do that to take ownership of the land and then let the state and lease its land to those who don't have the land, to have the land. And the second thing that you need to do, of course, is nationalization of the minerals, so that the minerals are used for the development of the people as a whole and not just a few minorities. Currently in South Africa, virtually all our minerals are foreign owned.
Yes.
And in fact, net property outflows, which is a critical thing in your book, has increased in 1995 to 2014 by 1,050%. That's how the net property outflows have increased in South Africa. So we can't grow. Cannot increase when we've got that type of property ownership.
Inherent or implicit in the question of inequality is not just the question of what causes poverty, but what causes wealth. And in the case of South Africa, one of the glaring inequalities that South Africans hardly ever talk about is the fact that within the education sector, our state spends an enormous amount of money on education. But if you look at how much private schools in South Africa actually cost, you will then see that no matter how much the state may continue to increase spending on a primary and high school education, the private school sector in South Africa far outstrips like the per capita, so per child spending, like by 1 to 100. And so that in itself is a form of inequality, which South Africans don't want to even talk about, precisely because it would mean targeting private school education and talking about why the state is failing to match that per child spending.